Hello and welcome to coverage of Grand Prix Providence. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Randy Bueller. And it's time for the quarterfinals. We have reached the top eight at long last. And in our table A there, you can see Pedro Carvalho. He's on the right-hand side. He comes from Brazil. He's playing a pretty cool four-color Sidisi whip deck that we'll talk about in a minute. But his opponent, 23rd in the world right now, Steve Rubin, on red-green dragons. Now, this isn't the deck that you'd see, that you'd expect to see here, which is more of a green devotion slash ramp deck. This is a full-on dragons deck here.
Okay, yeah, no devotion whatsoever. It's kind of like the old red-green dragon decks that had the target on their forehead going into the Pro Tour, except with instead of Dragon Lord Atarka, he's got all the Megamorph shenanigans, four Deathmist Raptors and a couple of Den Protectors. So, yeah, I mean, couple Havens, Draconic Roars, Thunderbreak Regents, and Stormbreath Dragons are the top of the curve here.
And as you can see, he's also running Deathmist Raptors and some Den Protectors as well. Just a couple Den Protectors to give him a little bit more of that mid to late game punch, get that card advantage rolling. Now, on the other side of the table, as we see Pedro resolving a Thoughtseize here, looking at really only one choice here with the Xenagos that's already in the graveyard there. What is Pedro up to here? You mentioned a minute ago that he is playing the same list that Willie Adel played here.
Indeed. It's a Sidisi whip list. It just happens to splash enough red mana for two copies of Dragon Lord Atarka.
Not a bad whip target either.
Exactly.
Wow. Comes in, does five, gains you five, hits for eight, gains you eight.
Yeah, no problem.
That's absurd. Meanwhile, Pedro is developing his mana here with a Sylvan Caryatid, but he's facing down a potent threat already here from Steve Rubin. Goblin Rabble Master is going to make a token. It's going to get blocked, but that thing's just going to sit there and threaten to do tons of damage to Pedro if he can't deal with it pretty quickly. Now, one thing about Pedro's list, not long on removal here, right? I see that there's three Murderous Cut in the list. Mm-hmm. But he's not really running, you know, the full package of removal that we see in some of these, although we do see a Hero's Downfall revealed here.
Yeah, two copies of Downfall, three copies
did
of
he
Murderous
miss?
Cut. He did miss.
Oh, jeez. That's tough.
I mean, sort of.
Yeah.
Sort of miss, right? He filled his graveyard with things that he will be happy to have there later.
Yeah, and he's continuing to do that.
Elemental.
There's a Torrent Elemental. There's a pretty cool interaction with that and the Whip of Erebos as well.
Never goes away forever. Comes back from exile. You can even delve it with Murderous Cut. Get it to exile that way, too.
Oh, yeah. Value. In the meantime, that Xenagos Reveler is going to hit the table. Pedro knew this was coming. And crunch, here comes a Satyr token and a pair of goblins as well. But the two Wayfinders are holding back the Goblin Rabble Master here. Pedro's going to take a quick browse of his graveyard before proceeding here. Now, this deck does only have the two Whip of Erebos in it.
Sidisi Undead Vizier helps. She can go get the whip in a pinch. It plays like it's got three whips.
Also, sometimes they get milled away, and then you can get them back with Den Protector.
Mm-hmm. Three copies of the Den Protector. It's a lot of access. I mean, it's definitely a whip deck. And the results look pretty good, right? Pedro, 13-2, into the top eight. Willie with a heartbreaker of a loss in the last round. I watched those games, too. Both his games against Patrick Dickman in the last round of the Swiss were very close, very hard-fought games. Willie goes 11-4. And I know from following him on Twitter, he felt like the deck was better than he was. That, you know, he didn't play it perfectly, but he felt really happy with the list.
All right, tokens abound here for Steve Rubin. He's going to make another one with Xenagos, and he's going to get the free one off of the Rabble Master. And he's going to line up an attack here. He's got a couple of Deathmist Raptors and a Mana Confluence in his hand. Yeah, get in there, says Steve Rubin. Jam with the team.
Makes sense.
This is going to incentivize Pedro to get in front of that rabble master.
Sure.
He may even feel like he wants to put his den protector in front. He has the mana right now to flip it up anyway. If he puts both of the Wayfinders in front and one of them dies to, like, a lightning strike type card or something like that, then he's going to have to deal with the rabble master again next turn. He's going to risk it. Yeah, I like it. Block like this, and this is all going to happen.
4 damage is coming through. Does Steve have a trick to save the rabble master?
No, he's just got 2 Deathmist Raptors and a land in his hand. But he does have 2 Deathmist Raptors. So
and land?
Yes. it's a mana confluence as well.
Oh, it's only turn 5. He can't play the 6th land for the 2nd Deathmist Raptor?
Nope. But he can play one of them. Pedro's down to 7. Would love to find a whip. Oh, he did find a whip. It's in his hand right now. He's still going to need another turn to really get it online, though.
Yeah, if he taps out for a whip here, he has to take 1 from Mana Confluence. He'll gain 2 life when he blocks with that morph. I don't know if that's good enough, though. Then he gets to untap with whip in play. It's close.
Well, he's going to go for the Satyr Wayfinder here to try to find that extra mana. He does. Oh, and there's Dragonlord Atarka that's going to hit the graveyard. We talked about this before the game, Randy. If he gets to flash that thing back, it'll clean up this board nicely. Get the land. Go down to 6. Play a land. And then he can play whip. And he'll have a 2-2 and a 1-1 with lifelink to hold off the army here. Risky business, but it will work.
Seems like the right line. He already made the risky double block with Wayfinder, so he has reason to believe that Steve Rubin is not sitting on an instant speed burn spell.
Exactly. Yeah, just getting back that Dragonlord Atarka would be such a huge swing.
I mean, I guess his other line is Den Protector to pick something up, but I don't know that he can do... I don't know that he can... has anything he can do with those other 2 mana that would approach the impact of getting the whip onto the table.
Yeah, it feels like he just needs to play the whip here. Then he can block the Wayfinder, probably just on the Deathmist Raptor, eat a token. That puts him to 9. He takes 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. He goes down to 2. But then he has the Dragonlord Atarka play.
To gain 13.
Yeah. Yeah, it's tough, but I think he might just have to take the risk.
I think 13. I tap out for whip here.
Yeah, gain 13, kill 2 satyrs and a goblin, and kill Xenagos.
I mean, the other advantage of not tapping out for whip, the advantage of the Den Protector line is that your Caryatid gets to block. So you sort of gain 2 life that way.
That's true. It's just tough because the whip's so expensive to use. Mm-hmm. He needs to get it down now so he can if he's going to use it next
right,
turn.
Right, right.
Yeah, he's got to count the other satyr that is going to come in. All right, he's going for it.
Yep. Looks right to me.
I like this play. I think this is the right one. And unless Steve Rubin draws something real spicy here off the top, I think it will work out for Pedro.
It doesn't
have
to be that spicy. Just has
something with haste or burn would be
right.
Nice. And an Elvish
right,
Mystic's
like
not it. Yeah.
Anything that does direct damage would have been good enough there.
That's what he wanted, and he didn't find it. So he found an Elvish Mystic. Pretty miserable draw here for Steve Rubin off the top of the deck, but he is still ahead on board. And he can force some chumps or some trades.
Wow.
Here.
He can see that a Tark is coming. Tarka can't kill everything.
No, a Tarka cannot kill everything, but
I mean
can kill 2 satyrs, a token, and Xenagos, and gain 13.
I mean, you just make a satyr and smash, right?
I think so.
Then follow up with Death Mist and maybe even the Mystic. Close your eyes. Brace for impact.
He could leave the goblins back if he wants here. as it's still a lethal attack, forcing blocks from Pedro, and they're all good attacks where the goblin can get blocked, gain Pedro 2 life, effectively nullifying a satyr anyway, but has him lose a goblin in the exchange.
Yeah, there is value in having the Den Protector, forcing the Den Protector to block something that's going to trade with it.
Steve Rubin keeps looking at his hand. There's nothing there. Pedro's got to be sweating this one out hard, though, because he went through as many of the iterations as he could, and he's just like, well, I hope he doesn't have it. Steve keeps looking at his hand. All right, in comes the biggest members of the team here.
Yeah, Pedro wants to gain 2 life with the morph. He has to trade it for a satyr.
And
he
does,
and he does. Gains 3, takes 4, net loss of 1.
And there's a replacement raptor.
Yeah.
And an elf
and
as well.
The mystic. Yeah, brace for impact. Reevaluate next turn.
Yeah, I mean, Pedro's line looks pretty. I wonder if he's got an additional play besides whipping back.
Yeah, he's got, what, 3 mana left over?
1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, he'll have 3 if he has an untapped land. Which I don't think he actually does. I think he's got an Opulent Palace. But here we go. One of the signature plays from this deck, Dragon Lord Atarka off of Whip of Erebos. So let's deal 5.
Now your line was so 5 to creatures and then attack Xenagos?
Yeah, I think that gets the most things off the board. Like kill an elf and 2 satyrs in this case.
Or elf, goblin, goblin, satyr.
Elf, goblin, goblin, satyr. That works too.
Yeah.
Gain 5, go to 9. And then you can attack Xenagos here and gain 8 more. So up to 17. What a huge swing.
Steve's crackback is for 10.
Yeah, it's a good crackback. That's why I'm wondering if Pedro has anything else to do. I saw that he drew Sidisi for the turn.
Okay.
But he doesn't have the mana to cast it this turn.
Right. Yeah. All right. Play Opulent Palace and hope 13 life was enough. He's going to carry at it to block satyrs, so the crackback's really only for 8.
There were 3 satyrs blocked. I blocked one. One of the satyrs was a Den Protector. And 1-1.
Are they trying to double block the life?
I think
double
they're getting
the life totals?
Getting the life totals all set, yeah. He gained 3 there, 5, and then another 8.
Another satyr just died. Had Pedro killed an additional satyr during combat last turn? Really? I mean, he did kill a satyr with his morph.
He did.
I thought there were
He blocked a satyr and chump blocked a raptor.
Right. He definitely killed a satyr in combat last turn. The question was, apparently they've convinced themselves it never left the red zone.
Yeah, it didn't seem wrong to me at the time, but looks like they've got it sorted out here. And Steve Rubin's going to take a look here. At the graveyard of Pedro. Meanwhile, he's going to rumble for 6. And pass a turn back, and this is huge.
Yeah.
Wow, right off the top there. The big stabilizer, Hornet Queen. Wow, he couldn't wait to play that.
Sure.
He barely even looked at it. Immediately slams it on the battlefield, and now he's stable. Now Steve Rubin's in a really big pickle here. He's
drawn back-to-back Draconic Roars, I believe. Has no dragon.
10. Pedro's going to want to get some amount of attacks in here.
Yeah.
And he's going to bring something
back.
He's
got Whip online, though.
He's got Whip online.
He can attack with... Yeah, whatever he whips back, plus some number of the death-touching flyers.
I wonder if it's going to be the Torrent Elemental here. That gets him in for 9 and puts him at 19. He can almost ignore the board at that point. Just attack with everything. No, it's going to be Sidisi, so he's going to continue to fuel his graveyard here.
And he may leave a zombie behind.
Yeah. All right, so we need a... trigger here, but what the trigger on the stack, Draconic War is going to take care of Sidisi. So the trigger still happens, he just won't get any zombies.
Right. And the exile from the whip still happens as well.
That's right, if it were to leave. All right, so he mills some lands there, and what's the follow-up here? Well, just a Sylvan Carry added, but he can get in for at least a few damage here and start bolstering up his life total a bit. Really? Doesn't want to attack with the actual queen?
He wants to block with the extra with the actual queen.
So that it gets in the yard. Yeah, that is a huge deterrent. You're right. BDM.
So I got a game update. Sky Mason is taking game one over Oliver TU. Really kind of Oliver turn one thought sees, took a courser, crew fix, hoped to take apart his hand, but turn four there was a Polukranos in play with seven or eight mana, a Hornet Queen waiting in the wings. He of course drew a courser of crew fix off the next turn. So pretty quick, brutal game for Sky Mason, up 1-0.
All right. Sky Mason, level two judge. Was going to judge this tournament. Decided not to.
He won a trial.
Yeah, he did.
He
not here.
He won two buys in a Grand Prix trial.
He's much more excited about going to this Pro Tour as a player than he was as a judge.
Yeah, there you go. All right, so Pedro gets his wish. We just talked about this. I was like, why didn't he attack? Oh, that's why. Because now he gets to block with his Hornet Queen and bring that back with the whip, just flooding the board with insect tokens in the process. And it's a morph for Steve Rubin.
Yeah, that's why Steve wasn't unhappy with attacking and losing his Raptors, because he can bring them back.
But now I think we're just going to see Pedro jam with all three insects plus the 2/2.
Yeah.
Hornet Queen. Putting him back up to a nice, tidy 20 life. Now he's got another play to start off with, though, and it's Sidisi. Trigger. And Steve says, hold on a second.
Same play? Draconic Roar in response to the trigger?
And he's got one. But is that a Den Protector face down there?
I think so.
He would give up the ability to turn that face up. I don't think he's super concerned about it, but...
Well, that means he gives up the ability to attack with his Raptors next turn. That's what he really gives up.
That's true. And he is going to kill Sidisi here. And he whiffed again. But he still has this Whip of Erebos activation.
Indeed.
And let's find that Hornet Queen. Buzz, buzz. Trigger. He's waiting on insect tokens here. He needs one more. There it is. That one goes there. And attack for 5. So Pedro jumps to 20. Rubin down to 14. And Pedro seems to really have the engine rolling here now.
Yeah.
You got to wonder if Rubin can overpower this. You know, Rubin's deck is more based on getting powerful threats down early and capitalizing on that. But Pedro just goes over the top at this point, right? I mean, this...
Hornet Queen,
look at this.
In exile.
Yeah, the Hornet Queen goes away.
The third little mechanical mistake Pedro's made already.
Yeah, I noticed that too. You know, he is a Magic Online player.
Okay.
Plays a lot on Magic Online, and that can lead to not playing quite as much in real life. But he has got to clean that up a little. We're in the top 8 here, so. All right, looks like they've got it sorted, though, and Pedro says, proceed, sir. So Ruben's going to flip a Den Protector. Get back a pair of Deathmiss Raptors. One face down, one face up. And with the Den Protector, he's going to get back
Rabble Master.
Which can actually start at least sending something into those insects he doesn't mind trading off with.
Right. That's the idea here. Maybe he can actually slog through 8 wasps.
Yeah.
Den Protector can't be blocked. But, yeah, the Satyr, just the Satyr, he takes the Goblin.
Took the Goblin. Interesting. Uh-oh, this looks big. Is it another one? Oh, this is Dragon Lord of Tarka. Sure.
Just hard casts.
So now he can take out the Goblin Rabble Master, and the Den Protector.
Or the Morph.
Or the Morph.
He leaves the Rabble Master?
I guess it doesn't matter.
I mean, it doesn't really matter,
but... I suppose not. I was surprised by that, too. But that's going to do it for game one here. Pedro Carvalho gets the engine running, dumps a bunch of stuff into his graveyard, and starts recurring it. But really, the big turning swing in that game was when he got to whip back Dragonlord Atarka.
Definitely.
And he's going to take game one. Steve Rubin's going to have to consult the sideboard and see if he has any answers to what Pedro's up to here.
So Josh McLean is also shuffling up for game two. That's McLean versus Eric Severson. And it is Severson who won the first game over there. That's a big match for Josh, by the way. He's playing for gold.
Josh is playing for gold here?
Yeah, he qualifies for 4 Pro Tours if he wins this match.
Wow.
Well, I guess he gets 1 for silver. So he qualifies for, it's a triple PTQ final for Josh McLean over there.
So huge for him.
Yeah, I mean, now he's got the Pro Tour. He can make points at the Pro Tour. There's a couple Grand Prix left that I gotta suspect he would go to if he was 1 point short of gold. But yeah, that ticket to the gravy train, gold status, carries with it an invitation to every Pro Tour next season. So Josh would like to lock that up. Like to get that in his back pocket and then worry about trying to put a big Pro Tour finish together to see if he can get to platinum.
Do we know where Severson's at pro points wise? You know,
he top 8 in Portland, right?
Portland,
isn't that him?
And then I think he also was on one of the team GP top 8s or top 4s in that case.
It's a fair question.
Yeah, we'll try to do a little research on that in the meantime, because he's definitely a name that I have seen pop up multiple times.
Yeah, I think it's his second GP. I think it's his second GP top 8 of the season.
Yeah.
I don't think he has any Pro Tour finishes to speak of to pair with that. But I'll see what I can figure out.
Looks like everybody's in shuffle mode here.
Yeah, he's
on
13 points for the season. So he's got 5. His 6 Grand Prix counting are 5, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1.
Okay, so the top 8 and then a bunch of men.
Yeah.
11 and 4s. All right.
And he did play a PT this season, but finished 247th. Trails David Williams on tiebreakers for 179th in the Player of the Year race. There's a lot of good Magic players out there playing a lot of good Magic.
Oh, yes. We get the distinct privilege of covering them quite often, including in the GP top 8 here.
Yeah, McLean on 28, replacing a 1 with this 4+. So currently on 31, which puts him 1 spot ahead of Luis Scott Vargas. LSV falls from 54th to 55th thanks to Josh McLean.
Oh, nemesis, huh?
Something like that. Make it an early peek in those games. Josh is on a relatively straightforward Obzon list. A lot of the face-to-face gamers, many of whom are Canadian, although Josh is not Canadian.
He's Iowan.
He is Iowan. But yeah, I mean, Obzon control, basically. The expensive side of the creature set, couple Elspeths, couple of Cruxes.
All right, well, looks like they're underway Megamorph, on that second sure. table, so we'll just pop in and catch the first few turns while our main match finishes resolving mulligans and shuffles.
Yeah, and Eric Severson, this is the guy. Man, that last round of the Swiss, that was one of the more brutal top decks I have seen.
That was nasty.
In a winning in.
Ugh.
Josh Ravitz had just baited out Disdainful Stroke with Elspeth, baited out another Disdainful Stroke with the other Elspeth. Here comes the Ugin he's been setting up for the entire game, and then you just feel as thousands of Twitch viewers wince as Severson, who was empty-handed when his previous turn started,
yep.
shows the third Disdainful Stroke. That was brutal.
That was one heck of a top deck there from Severson.
Josh had played that game so well, too. But no top 8 for you, Josh Ravitz.
All right, let's jump back over to game one, or excuse me, table one here. as we venture into game two. Pedro Carvalho winning that first game, there was that really important turning point where he had to pass the turn back, and almost anything would have killed him. Burn spells,
tapped out
haste
for whip
creatures, but he was able to turn that corner. And here's Steve Rubin doing what he wants to do now, getting off to a quicker start. Turn three Rabble Master is going to make a goblin, and the Elvish Mystic is going to hit the red zone as well. And a slow start for Pedro. You can see some of the mana woes that you can have, but wow, Pedro has drowned in sorrow to just wipe the board here.
And the, I mean, the games where you're playing against the red aggro, there's just, they've just, after sideboarding, they split into these two flavors. There's the games where you have turn three drown, and then there's the games where you don't have turn three drown. It is such an impactful card. Just completely changes the way these games play out.
Yeah, I mean, it felt like Pedro was behind and struggling, and now it feels like he's way ahead.
How every sort of slowish, controlish deck feels against red aggro.
Wow.
Not that Steve is, you know, it's not like he's playing a Tarka red. It's not like he's on Martin Deng's list or anything, but with that draw, it felt that way.
Pedro's just going to chump block. And another Raptor for Rubin. So not an explosive start for him, but a reasonable one. Pedro just wants lands. He just saw a land with his Scry land there. And he'd like to just pick up another. He passes the turn back, and now Steve has to wonder, what are you going to get? Well, first and foremost, there's a Deathmoth Raptor that can trade.
He can pick up a Drown. He can pick up a Courser. He can pick up a Wayfinder, depending on how he wants to play the next couple turns. We're assuming that's a Den Protector. I guess it could be a Raptor for all we know, right?
I think it was a Den Protector. I think I saw it. Okay. Certainly has the mana lined up as such.
Mm-hmm. He's representing Den Protector for sure.
Yeah, it is. And so now Rubin has to decide, well, let's say it's a Den Protector. He's going to assume that. Now what happens?
Attack. He says, well,
Pedro,
I'm all right.
Wait.
I'm all right with all these trades, says Steve Rubin. It's better than not attacking.
We're going to need to get that overlay off of there. He could get a Courser. He could also hit the Wayfinder. Hit the Wayfinder back to keep those land drops flowing. Again, he did keep a land on top of his library, but I think I like just getting a Courser here, right?
Yeah, I mean, the 2/4 body's relevant. The life gain is relevant.
I'm with you. All right, now blocks. Block. Yeah, Pedro is fine just getting rid of everything here. And looks like Steve Rubin's okay with that, too, as he plays a Rattleclaw Mystic to get back his two Deathmist Raptors.
That's why he was okay attacking and trading.
Yep. There's that land that he had left on top, and you can see why Pedro's got in his hand Dragonlord Atarka. He's also drawn a Frontier Bivouac. You can see it on the table there. And he's just going to do all five to the morph here. But this isn't going to work out too great for Pedro, as those two Deathmist Raptors are coming back. He will ultimately kill the Rattleclaw. Poor Pedro's only got an 8/8 flying trample for all of his troubles.
Yeah, what is Steve Rubin supposed to do about it?
I don't know.
Roast
ridiculous.
Plus Draconic Roar or something like that?
Yeah, he's got the roast half of that equation.
What's the green
in
card
hand?
In his hand? He doesn't have Plummet, does he? Good.
He keeps shuffling it. He just drew a Xenagos. No, it's not a Plummet.
He does have one Plummet in his sideboard.
Okay, it might be a Plummet. No, it doesn't look like a Plummet. All right, well, attack with both of these, pass a turn.
How is it that one guy's playing a Dragon's deck and the other guy is winning with Atarka?
That doesn't seem right, does it?
Not really.
This isn't a whip, is it?
Oh, God.
Is it a back to nature? What is that in it? It is a back to nature.
Oh, all right.
All right, well, that works. That made this game at least within reach now. For
he still
Steve
has
Rubin.
To find a way to kill.
Oh! Immediate other Whip of Erebos on top. He's only got the two, right? Oh, man. Pedro Carvalho.
And I feel
hot.
Like, yeah, the big flyer might win this game all by itself.
Yeah. I mean, it's three hits and it just kills you. And if it has lifelink, you can't race the thing. I mean, this is the argument to playing decks like what Pedro's playing or playing the Green Devotion decks is just to go over the top of these Death Mist Raptor. You know, you're okay, cute. You know, you're grinding out some advantage, but ultimately you've just got three threes. I've got an 8/8 trample. It could have lifelink.
Roasts the Courser and then smashes. That roast is no longer going to get pointed at Atarka.
No, Atarka's here to stay. And as Atarka, I'm assuming he's just going to hit Steve. Because that kills
Makes
him next turn
me.
Without an answer, and in answering this when you're in red-green is quite difficult. Pedro's at 16. He's very unlikely to take that much damage, especially with two caryatids on the battlefield. So I like that a lot from Pedro.
Wow.
Just ignore the Planeswalker. There's just not much that Steve Rubin can do against Dragonlord Atarka here. He draws a Rabblemaster for the turn, and that should do it. That's it. Pedro Carvalho advances. Wow, this deck looked great on camera. You know,
did.
He did have that one tight turn in game one where he could have easily
lost. Yeah,
tap out
for whip, close my eyes, hope I'm alive to untap next turn. But he was.
Oof.
Now he'll be untapping in the semifinals.
Well, Steve Rubin, he was our highest ranked player in the top eight.
Yeah. You know, the other place he's 23 is in the Battle for Worlds. I don't know if I'm the only one who keeps obsessing about this, but the Steve Rubin loss, that is... Oh, Roast doesn't hit flyers, of course. Sorry about that. This top eight loss for Steve Rubin is good news for Josh Utter Layton. It's good news for Yvonne Flock.
So what does it clear up for them?
There is now Rubin and Josh Utter Layton are the bubble boys for Worlds. Rubin's actually on 49. Josh is on 48. And in 24th place in Worlds right now, Yvonne Flock is on 47,
right.
A point back, and currently on the wrong side of the bubble looking in.
We'll be keeping an eye on that. Speaking of keeping an eye on it, BDM.
We have our, I assume while I was away, did Steve Rubin lose that match?
He did.
Yeah.
So we have one semifinalist. We have another semifinalist in Sky Mason.
Oh.
Sky went two games very quick. Game two, his opponent had Drown in Sorrow, Crux of Fate, but he just kept chugging along, eventually got Dragonlord Atarka out, and Dragonlord Atarka trumped five colored dragons. All the
story
way down
of my
the line.
Day, BDM.
Like, yeah, you know, basically, last turn, he's like, "Do you have something to deal with Dragonlord Atarka?" He's like, "No," and just conceded, and that was the game. So Guy Mason through to the semifinals.
Yeah, we've seen a lot of that here. Randy, you and I were coming up with like convoluted two-card combos to try to kill Dragonlord Atarka, and,
which didn't
and they
even
didn't
work.
Even work anyway.
Yeah.
Not that he had them. All right, here comes Death Mist Raptor, and we see a block here from Severson. And Josh McClain looks like he's about to even things up here. This is going to need to be an end hostilities here. And it's going to be
a scoop
phase instead. So Josh McClain does, in fact, even things up. And we're going to get a game three between these two.
Playing for gold. One win from three more Pro Tour invites for Josh McClain.
Oof, one game win?
One game win from three Pro Tour invites.
Anybody that's ever played in a PTQ knows. You feel the heat even when it's just for one, when it's three. Now, I have to say, Josh looks like he's in the zone, though. I don't think he's thinking much about it.
Well, unlike a PTQ, it's not like you have to go, you know, win the Swiss and win the quarters and the semis again. He's...
Look at... the top half of our bracket's all ready to go there. Semifinalist Pedro Carvalho is going to face off against level two judge Sky Mason. And now GP top eight competitor Sky Mason. So that one's ready to go.
Does Pedro have a Grand Prix top eight before?
I
know he's
so.
Been doing a fair amount of traveling with Willie.
Yeah. Maybe a modern one.
Rashad remembers him losing to Eggs in a modern GP. Oh, Pro Tour.
To Sivka?
Oh, he was in Stanislav Sivka's top eight. Okay.
Pro Tour return to Ravnica?
Yeah, it's Tiago Sopra. He did pretty much lose instantly. Yeah, but you see people talk about Willie as a community leader, But, I mean, look at all the Brazilian players he keeps bringing to events who do well. Like Pedro Carvalho now has this Grand Prix top eight to go with that Pro Tour top eight. Thiago Saporito, same kind of situation, right? He studies with Willie, plays at Willie's store, comes to the Pro Tour with Willie. Might beat Willie out for a world spot on the Latin American invite on the strength of Thiago's Pro Tour top eight earlier this year. Oh, Pedro's, this is actually Pedro's third GP top eight of the year. He's got a couple of quarterfinal exits. First time he's got as far as the semis, but two GP top eights so far this season.
He just might have the tech to get there this time, too. Yeah. Willie finished 11-4, but he was really happy with the deck.
Yeah.
I mean, not that we all haven't heard that before, right? You know, my deck's super awesome. Didn't do so great or whatever, but I believe Willie. I think he really thinks this deck is awesome.
Yeah, Pedro finished 55th at a Pro Tour this season as well, so making money on both the Pro Tour and the Grand Prix circuits. 21 points. He's starting to close in on being able to think about gold. And he'll be 26. He'll be within less than 10 points away.
Put up a run at the Pro Tour or a couple of
another
sweet
GP
finish, yeah.
I don't think Willie's done going to GPs.
Oh, no.
1 point for platinum.
No, he'll have a travel partner if he wants to go to them. There's no doubt about that.
I'm guessing it won't be hard for those guys to decide between Singapore and Buenos Aires.
No. No, that one will be easy. All right, no pressure, Josh McClain. So what if he loses here, Randy?
Mm-hmm.
Then what does he need to do to get to gold? Will he have closed the gap with this top eight?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. He is on, he passed Luis, right? He's 54th now. So, where's his point total? Josh, 28. He's getting he's replacing a 1 point finish with four point finish.
Okay.
So he's turning a 3 point profit on the weekend, even if he loses this match, to get to 31. If he does more than the minimum 3 points in Vancouver, he's gold. If he puts up an X3 result at any of the remaining GPs this season, that would also get him gold.
Okay, so he's put himself in a good position either way, but oh, it would be nice for him to just clean it up right here with this game.
Exactly.
But he's got to get through Eric Severson playing Bant Megamorph.
Yeah, I mean, while he's got options, it's just like, okay, you've got one or two, maybe, I don't think three GPs. I don't know that he's going to Singapore or Buenos Aires. He's got a couple of GPs, but you have to go 10-3. That's hard. It's not trivial.
Very difficult.
Like, when's the last time Owen Turtenwald went X3? He keeps coming to all these GPs. He's obviously one of the best players in the game. I mean, there's no question there.
Yeah.
But 11-4, 11-4, 11-4, 10-5. It's, magic is hard.
Josh McClain has a turn three Deathmiss Raptor, which is going to answer the turn three Deathmiss Raptor from Eric Severson. They're getting a little ahead of themselves here as Josh is searching up a land. It could be a forest. Okay. So far, toe-to-toe.
It's an alpha forest, right? It's not even beta? Looking at the corners look alpha to me.
I think they're just beta worn to alpha status. Yeah. Yeah, that forest has seen better days. Looks like it's been the victim of some hard shuffling. No sleeves.
I mean, it's probably older than most of the people in this top eight, right?
That's a great point, yeah. Probably is true. All right, so Eric is deciding if he wants to keep what I think was a fleece main line on top. Well, whatever it was, it's going away. And he is going to go ahead and attack with his Raptor. Josh is going to take it, drop down to 16, and just pass a turn back from Eric here. Josh not interested in trading Deathmiss at this point. He thinks he can get a bunch of damage through here, so he's going to attack for 3, dropped Eric down to 17. And then what? Well, the question of then what is a perplexing one for Josh. He's really taking some time to make this decision. I think he can go land Siege Rhino if he wants, but then he's got a tap land follow-up. He does go land Siege Rhino, and that is going to get Disdainful Stroked. I think Josh...
God, those Disdainful Strokes have been so good for
him. Yeah, they have. I think Josh, you know, had a good idea that that might happen here. No play from Severson, you know. He just passed.
Yeah.
But he's got a land to play here. And he's going to attack. 3 damage with Deathmiss Raptor is going to drop McLean down to 13. Is this a Hornet Nest?
No,
den this is a Den Protector face down. Pass a turn back. Disdainful Stroke's the only card in the graveyard that I can see here. Though I'm sure he wouldn't mind having that back in. Oh, he. This is super.
Also holding one, isn't he?
Yeah, well, so Josh McLean just drew a Wingmate Rock.
Oh,
and he's going for it here.
Oh, these Disdainful Strokes.
Man, Eric Severson needs to just frame these Disdainful Strokes. They have been so good for him. And he's had one at each of the right time. And again, Josh McLean knows that it's a possibility here.
Yeah.
But
he baited one. Wow. No Wingmate Rock. No token. That, what a huge swing.
Yeah, both of them. Siege Rhino and Wingmate Rock being held at bay by Disdainful Stroke. Keeping Eric Severson just ahead of Josh McLean in the tempo race here. He's exactly one morph ahead on board. He's doing the math. If he wants to flip up the Den Protector now and attack with both, that's exactly half of Josh McLean's remaining life. He can set up a 2-turn clock. He's looking at a Valorous stance here, and yeah, he's going to do that. So here's 6 damage. Disdainful Stroke back to hand for Eric Severson, which is a nice insurance plan against a lot of the things that Josh can play that could stabilize here. And Severson is going to rely on those Disdainful Strokes. He's just going to pass the turn back. It's going to be a pretty big deal here, too.
Josh has got what?
He's
Obs on Charm.
He's got an Obs on Charm
Crux?
To take out one of these creatures. Yes, he has a Crux, which he's going to play here, presumably to draw out the Disdainful Stroke from Severson, which he does. Now he can leave his Deathmiss Raptor back. I think that Severson does have a Valorous stance here that he can use to push through. Whoops.
Almost dropped it.
Not quite what he wants to do with it, but it's close. Busy hands there from Severson. He's also got a Fleece Mainline and a Sylvan Carry added. Crunch with both.
Den Protector. Now, Josh would love to see Valorous Stance save that Den Protector.
Yes. And it's not an unreasonable play here for
Severson
either.
No, it's not. It's totally reasonable for Eric Severson.
He can do that. And he could even play a replacement Den Protector, or another Den Protector, I should say. And
yeah,
really try to set up lethal.
I don't know about tapping out for Den Protector, though. I mean, if he does that, Josh is deliriously happy.
You want him to just leave up the mana here? Or just leave up the mana and
well
just
I mean,
say
playing
go?
A Den Protector when you can't flip it is always a little bit risky.
Oh, yeah, totally. Especially with a Raptor on board. He does have 2 lethal threats here.
Right. Right. Do you need the 3rd lethal threat? Maybe. I mean, it's a judgment call. It's not...
He could also just play this, the Fleece Mane, and one that...
Oh,
you know,
yeah, that seems way better than the
Den
Protector.
That still
and
gives
it still
him
plays
plan.
Straight into the second Crux.
It does indeed. But he's going to be able to populate his board back quite quickly. He's basically going to have the same board minus the Fleece Mane next turn if he wants it. So Crux is going to clean away all of Severson's cards. But he's just going to immediately play another Den Protector, pass the turn back. And with the two mana available, he can get that Death Mist ready to attack as well. So huge pressure on McLean here to do something. He's got that Obzon Charm. Mm-hmm. It's not going to do anything currently. But he needs to do Obzon Charm plus something else to make it work.
Obzon Charm is actually a pretty good answer to the Death Mist.
Yeah, if he was at four
life.
If Eric
brings it face up, which he probably will because Josh is at three. But Josh can't take a hit from the Den Protector either.
No.
Is he holding Nissa? Is that what he's holding?
No, I think he's holding a Johnny, yeah.
Yeah,
Mentor of Heroes, which doesn't help either.
And Den Protector bringing back Death Mist and putting a Den Protector in his hand.
And that's going to do it. Josh McLean extends the hand, and Eric Severson is going to move on to the semifinals. So moving forward for Josh McLean as far as pro points towards gold goes, but he's not quite able to seal the deal here today in Providence. He's going to have to pick up another strong finish either at the Pro Tour or at one of the upcoming GPs in between.
Yep.
Bittersweet for Josh McLean. I mean, he's got to be happy that he's moved himself closer to that goal of reaching gold, but he would have loved to put a button
on it. You always feel good about making the top eight. Anytime you show up to a big event like this, top eight feels good, even if it's not, even if you dreamed about more. You know, Steve Rubin's got to feel good about his top eight. I mean, if Steve Rubin had won this, he could have just absolutely locked up Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he could have been up there with, you know, Paul Rietzel above the sort of Owen Turtenwald, Brad Nelson level if Steve Rubin had put a couple more wins together.
All right,
but
like
hey, still got points, still got Tortoise Gold.
Yeah.
Just like Josh McLean is 1 point away from knowing he gets to stay on tour. It's better than being 4 points away, which is where he was this morning.
So that leaves us with one match left over here. It looks like Raif Istvan and Neil Sachs are still rumbling.
I think that's our turbo match?
And it's our turbo match. So they might even be done. But we're going to find out here. Okay, Raif on the left side, Neil Sachs on the right. What are they playing, Randy? See a carry added on the left there off of two forests, and there's a mountain, so I'm going to assume red-green here. Red-green ramp for Reef.
I don't know what they're playing. Okay. I don't have deck lists.
Well, we'll just guess. Red-green ramp on the left, and on the right we're going to say Obzon Aggro.
I would love to see deck lists, but I don't know where they are.
Well, I called it for you, so we did it. All right, pair of Fleece Mane Lions now for Neil Sachs.
What did you call these decks?
I called it Obzon Aggro and Red Green Ramp.
Okay. Red Green Ramp is ambiguous, though. Is it Devotion or is it Dragons?
I'm calling it Devotion.
Okay. I agree. Fleece Mane Lion and Genesis Hydra basically pin it down to those two archetypes, I think.
Correct. Now, a Death Dealer, that would be conclusive evidence.
Correct. But pretty much, I mean, most of the Obzons have eschewed even the Fleece Manes these days.
It's true.
In favor of all the Megamorph mid-range grindy stuff.
All right, double Fleece Mane battle zone here. And it looks like Reef is not interested in taking a bunch of damage here, so he's going to trade slash block. You got to think that Reef is trying to set up for something huge here. As Unoffensive the Foremost and Fleece Mane hit the red zone, Unoffensive triggers, puts a counter on Fleece Mane Lion as well. So a pair of 4/4s.
Kind of always setting up for something huge with the Devotion deck.
Yeah.
Doesn't have a nick though. Is the big
he double
problem.
Blocks and gets away with it there, killing Unoffensive the Foremost. And there's a Death Dealer. Oh, and there's a replacement Unoffensive. So Neil Sachs pretty happy to get the trade there. And this is Whisperwood Elemental now. It wasn't quite as big as I was thinking, but that'll certainly work. Wow, everybody in the red zone here. 3-3 death dealer. On offensive, the foremost is a 4-4. And the fleece main line is currently a 4-4, but could go monstrous here. And it looks like Neil's decided not to monstrous the fleece main here because he's got a siege rhino. That's going to knock Reef Istvan down to 4 here. Wow, he goes to 3 off of a fetch land?
What do you need that mana for? Is that a Tarka? Or a giant Genesis Hydra?
For a
Genesis Hydra for 7?
Yes, which does get him into the range to actually hit a Tarka.
7, but he misses.
Yeah, sort of. But he's put himself in Siege Rhino range here. Difference between 4 and 3 can be pretty big against this Obzon deck.
Fair. Get a Whisperwood. Yeah, he could have got the Whisperwood without cracking that fetch land. But yeah,
he
7
couldn't have gotten
like
Dragon
Lord
of Tarka, or if he's got main deck.
I would crack fetch land to get Genesis Hydra up to 7 there.
Okay. I mean, his opponent is top decking, so it's not like you can just say, oh, he's definitely got a Siege Rhino.
Right, right. Exactly.
But they do travel in packs. It's a known fact. It's called a crash of rhinos.
He manifested.
Dragon Lord of Tarka. Well, now he's going to try to close this game out as quickly as possible because of that top deck potential. Monstrous of Fleece main line because why not?
Yeah, but...
But it's not getting
two
in.
Manifests a turn and a Tarka.
Here's a top deck. Is it a rhino?
Oh!
It is! It is a rhino! Wow, we know what Neil's middle name is now, don't we? Neil L. Sachs takes the first game here against Raif Istvan. Woo!
You just gave him a middle initial of L?
Yeah, luck.
I understand. Just wanted to make sure your brilliance was appreciated by all.
I wish I had the same name as him. Wow, that was insane. He was going to die.
Pretty
I mean,
much.
Like, probably next turn. Self-inflicted wound, though, is going to take down, I believe, a Rattleclaw Mystic there. And Hero's Downfall leaves behind a Satyr after it kills Xenagos. And here's another one. So you see Raif just slowly, incrementally gaining advantage here. Even though his threats are being killed, he's leaving behind more of them. And in this case, Xenagos still around. Thank you, Rashad. Polukranos World Eater for Reef, who looks to be out to a nice lead here over Neil. And, you know, in the first game, we saw Neil really play the aggressive role, and he was attacking until Reef finally turned the corner and was able to flood the board with the help of two Whisperwood Elemental. Thank you, Randy. And then turn the corner with the Dragon Lord of Tarka. Unfortunately, he had fallen all the way to 3 life, which put him in Siege Rhino range, which was looming on top of the library.
I like our chances of a game 3 right
but,
now.
Not
going to lie.
This one looks pretty good for Reef. Who has enough creatures to just start chump blocking the Fleet's main lion here. Self-inflicted wound when your opponent has already played a Hornet Queen is a pretty miserable place to be. Uh-oh, this is going to be something huge. Genesis Hydra. Reef goes big. He pluses his Xenagos, and he found a Dragon Lord of Tarka. That's going to kill the Onofenza. It's going to clear the way for the victory, probably.
One more turn? Nope, lethal already.
Yeah, I wonder if Xenagos was going to go ultimate there, too. He'd worked him up to six loyalty, but game three it is. And looks like they're right quickly underway. And a quick start here for Arif again. He's got a turn one elf into a morph. If it's a Rattleclaw Mystic, he could generate... Oh! Yeah, it was a Rattleclaw Mystic, but once again, we see the power of Drown and Sorrow. You mentioned it a minute ago, wiping away everything and then following it up with Siege Rhino. So Neil Sachs with a really nice start here, though we do see Reef slowly building up his mana base, and now he's got, well, some semblance of blockers here. Whoa! Easy there, Neil. Looks like he's just going to attack Xenagos here.
I think so.
And yeah, chump block.
Blocks.
Yeah, it's going to save Big Daddy there. And Rakshasa the Death Dealer is going to be the follow-up play here for Neil Sachs, who passes a turn. And you see the big top deck from Isfahan. He kind of lifted it up in the air. He must have needed something. Well, he found something. And I think that was a Whisperwood that he hit off
so
of the Genesis Hydra too. So huge play there for Reef.
There wasn't a target in there, but it was Hydra for five.
Mm.
So
he hit the best possible target, though it does get Hero's Downfallen immediately.
Yep. Doesn't even spit off a manifest.
Nope. And here comes Rakshasa Death Dealer, which gets not blocked. Okay. And, you know, when you've got a lot of mana on the table, Warden of the First Tree is not bad at all to pick up here. It's a great mana sink for this deck. Really sort of pulling double duty where you can play it on turn one and level it up to a 3-3 and just keep beating down with it. But then when it gets to the later part of the game, that thing can get completely out of hand. Right now it's a 3-3. He can make it a 3-3 trampler now, and the next turn he can put 5 plus one counters on it repeatedly, too. Every turn he can do it. And, you know, that's really, really tough for a deck like Isfahan's to deal with. I mean, these burn spells just can't keep up at some point. All right, he just did it. So that thing's a level two now. And now he actually has the ability already to start dumping counters onto it. Now that's, again, where a card like Hornet Queen starts to look amazing. But he's got 5 plus one counters, and he passes the turn back. He's just going to wait until it's big enough to get through. Oh, no. I guess it was a Whisperwood, but it died?
No, those are still in play.
They're still in play. Okay.
Whisperwood manifest was another Whisperwood.
Yes, it was.
Which got flipped over, so now two manifests a turn.
Jeez, even this Warden of the First Tree is going to have a hard time outpacing that. A 5-5 Genesis Hydra plus two manifests per turn. Plus, there's, of course, the Whisperwood sitting there and a trio of Caryatids just for chump blocks as well.
Oh!
And a Hornet Nest, too. Well, this plan has not gone well for Neil Sachs.
What just happened?
That is brutal. Now, he does have a lot of removal that can take out the Hornet Nest.
It got to block the Warden.
It
blocked the Warden. Now, the Warden tramples over, so there's only two Hornets,
yes.
But still.
But only one is what he needs here, and it looks like we've caught up to real time here.
Yeah.
Neil Sachs finds himself at 33.
Manifested
with
Hornet Nest.
With a 13-13 Warden of the First Tree with Trample and Lifelink. Oh, wow. This game's been sweet.
Yeah. I mean, he's got the Hornets that he needs to Death Touch, but he has to worry about all the trample damage. So what, Caryatids are going to join the team just to soak up the trample?
Yeah, that's what they're doing. I mean, this thing threatens to be an 18-18 with trample here. With Isfahan down to seven life, he really does have to respect
Jeez.
This. Wow. So he's put three manifests, two Caryatids, and then the one Death Toucher on there as well. And he's going to put the other Death Toucher on. That plays around a single spot removal spell.
Sure, sure.
He's counting it up now to see what kind of damage. Remember, it's 18. So 3,
Isn't
6, 7, 8,
5, 5, 5, 1.
Five
counters
five.
For the ability,
but
isn't
its base power and toughness is
it's
three.
It's three. Yeah, okay. 18, of course.
So he's got 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 right now. Toughness in front of that thing. Let's make it 19. All right, everything but his Whisperwoods jumps in front. He's just like, heck with it. So, six mana, put another five counters on this guy.
Yeah, I mean, you gain five life and get to kill more things.
Yeah.
So, it's a totally reasonable way to spend your mana.
He's got to order these blockers, though. You got to figure the morph can get flipped up here.
How much combined? Is there a morph or they all manifest?
The one on the far right's a morph.
Seven. Yeah, okay.
It could also just be a Rattleclaw, though, in which case you would just want to leave it morphed.
There's 21 toughness in play in front of that thing. I count. I got 21.
Six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
I got 21 also. So this has Raif taking no damage.
Yeah, he's going to take zero.
But he's going to lose a bunch here. But, you know, I like this play from him. Look at the two Whisperwoods. They're ready to just populate out of board.
Agreed.
Right quick here.
Yeah, kill the Morph, kill the Hydra, kill the two Death Touchers. And now start, I assume Manifests are better to kill than Carry Edits?
Yes.
If it was 21.
Also, you get to kill three Manifests instead of two Carry Edits.
Yeah, you can kill everything except two Carry Edits. Because I think how this works.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. Yeah, you're right. And then one damage goes onto a Carry Edit or whatever.
Mm-hmm. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
That's his.
Is that how he did it?
Why would you put the Hornets at the back?
Wow, he let the Hornets live?
That is surprising to me.
It is, because remember, he's still got the Death Dealer and the Siege Rhino in play here. I mean, that did a lot of work, don't get me wrong, but working through those insects can be pretty
tough. Yeah, he could have killed two insects instead of one Carry Edit.
Still, that Warden of the First Tree
did some work.
Songs will be sung about that
51
one.
51 to 7.
But it still favors Raif Istvaan here, like pretty strongly, right? Those Whisperwood Elementals going untouched here are just going to completely dominate. He just doesn't need much more. And now that he has the two Death Touchers back as well, he's passing, manifesting twice. So what can Neil do here? Can send in the Siege Rhino.
Yeah, if it wasn't for the Death Touchers.
Cool, he just drew a Drowning Sorrow.
Okay, is that why he didn't care about the Hornets?
He just drew it. So he's psychic or whatever, but maybe he was playing to that out. Did he scry it to the top last turn? That's possible, too. At any rate, he's got it here. He's going to pump up his Death Dealer, which, you know, Reef's like, uh-oh. Drop down to 50 life. And he's just going to run it out there right now. So that's going to kill both of the insects and presumably both of the manifests, though that isn't necessarily the case. It was in this scenario.
Right.
And shrink down the Carry Edit and the Whisperwoods. Of course, the Siege
Rhino
too, yeah. And he's going to attack with both the 2-2 Rakshasa Death Dealer.
Is it? It's 2-2? Yeah.
Yeah, he pumped it beforehand.
So he could, but he can't pump it again.
No.
He has green, white, white. So Whisperwood could trade with Death Dealer in theory.
Yeah.
Carry Edit could chump block Death Dealer.
What he's trying to do is set up the win. He's got two copies of Self-Inflicted Wound in hand. So if he can get Istvaan down to four, he feels like he can fire those off next turn and win the game.
That's Whisperwood chump blocking Rhino?
Yes.
Wouldn't you double block at that point? It's a 2-3 Rhino.
It is a 2-3 Rhino.
You just put the other Whisperwood in front of the Rhino and the Rhino dies and you keep your Whisperwood.
Did he take any damage on that turn though, Raif? Shows him
no.
At seven still, so
he didn't
nothing?
Take any damage.
Okay, well that's super important here.
No, I'm just, why not put the second Whisperwood
no,
in front
I
of the
I agree.
Rhino?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, his opponent had white, white, green up. Nothing was happening there. Okay, self-inflicted wound you. Can he flip that thing up? He looks at his hand again, but it's just another copy of Nykthos. And he's going to have to lose his Hornet Nest. And another self-inflicted wound is going to take out Whisperwood. He's going to sack it in response. And he gets to crash into the red zone here, even with a pump for his Rakshasa Death Dealer. Wow! Neil Sachs wins that game. Look at that guy. He's like, yeah, hey, we did it. So he's going to advance to the semifinals as well. Woo. That was crazy.
Yes.
Neil L. Sachs gets there.
Yeah, no, I'm just thinking about the blocks on Rafe's on the next to last turn, the Drown and Sorrow turn. Felt like putting Whisperwood chump blocking Rhino. Whisperwood could also have traded with, like, even if he just blocks the other creatures, Whisperwood could have chump blocked. Caryatid could have chump blocked Rhino. Whisperwood could have traded with Death Dealer.
Caryatid, yes, chump blocks Rhino. He takes one.
Oh, he takes one trample, which maybe cares about 6 versus 7.
Yes. I mean, we're talking 2 Siege Rhinos.
Yeah, I mean, it's
range.
Tough.
I mean, you're getting into minimum 2 card combos at that point to kill you.
But yeah, if he, it feels like